Mr. Jim Lehman, who's also an elder at the Blaisdell Chapel and a part of the family. He has some life reflections. Jim?
Thanks, Mike. Good to see everyone here today. And a lot of memories we have for our brother Dave. Eh? David Carl Stifler, to begin his story, the most important event of his life occurred when he was 7 years old, the day he trusted Christ for forgiveness of sins. It happened in this way. Convicted of sin but unsaved, he attended a gospel meeting where the preacher closed in prayer, asking that the Lord would, that anyone not saved would not be able to sleep that night. The prayer was answered, as little Dave was unable to sleep, terrified of being unsaved. Finally, he asked his mother for help, and she quoted Romans 10 and 9, "If thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in thine heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved." He believed and was born again that night and fell asleep at peace with his Savior. Some of Uncle Dave's favorite things. He loved his mother's fruitcake, braid, kuchen, and potato latkes, double yolk eggs. He would also often say it's the yolk that has all the flavor. Pancakes. And in fact, that was his birthday breakfast. Saltwater taffy every year from the Erie County Fair. He'd take us up to the fair, and we go all through the fair and pass out tracts and stuff. And there was always that taffy place behind the clubhouse there. Many of you have been there. Let's see. Russell Stover's chocolates. Nuts and Chewy, of course. Dove chocolates. Lindt chocolate. I see a pattern. Especially Lindt or truffles, to name a few. In case you didn't pick up on it, Uncle Dave had a sweet tooth. Uncle Dave was raised by his father, Raymond Stifler, and his mother, Lillian Stifler, first-generation Americans. They built a home and family on the cornerstone and foundation that Jesus Christ is Lord. Uncle Dave and his siblings, RJ, Paul, Pearl, and Bill, all were taught God's word, including if you don't work, you don't eat. This probably is why, in years later, he would invite us over for pizza and wings when he got back into town from family meetings. The work came first. You had to unpack all the felts and the tripods and that kind of stuff, you know. We knew we'd be unloading his car full of felts and prizes. There was always a job to do. Uncle Dave loved playing board games. He liked to play Shanghai, Mennonite Madness, Dutch Blitz, African Marble Game, and Farkle, a dice game. I can't picture Dave. Well, never mind. We won't go there. I don't know if any of you took dice to camp. I would imagine David would have caught you. I never saw many down there when I was a camper. He probably developed this love from all the times his parents played Scrabble with the family in the evening in order to learn English. I just learned this as they gave me this to read. He also loved the family reading together. The attitude was, while we're in America, we speak English, not German. That's not politically correct now, with some people coming over, you know. But it's interesting, his grandfather came over from Germany, settled in the south side of the first ward of Buffalo, and moved two or three times before he came to Blaisdell and built a home on Martin. He came directly from Germany, so that was his grandfather. He had one disappointment. He couldn't take lessons. The rest of his siblings all took piano lessons. But there wasn't enough time for practicing after school before Dad came home. So he just taught himself how to play piano instead of going for lessons and practicing. Excuse me. All the children were expected to take responsibility within the family. His father told the principal there would be no homework for his children. Kids, wouldn't you like to have a father like that? The school had him for the day. The family had him at night. They were supposed to help the family. Learning responsibility and hard work. Discipline, according to the scripture, was important, Dave. His father, Raymond, had a saying that has been handed down to generations. The Board of Education is to be applied to the seat of knowledge, seat of learning. Later in life, Uncle Dave would add, with love, adding the bear hugs and whisker rubs as well. Some of you have been victims, participants with that. Uncle Dave had various jobs. He learned construction with his dad, which was an asset with all the crafts and projects he would do. He worked as a florist at one point. He tried to enlist in the Army, but was unable to due to health issues. He desired to be a doctor and go to Africa, but the Lord showed him clearly this was not to be his mission field. He helped his father renovate houses for resale before it became the rage. During this time, he was already beginning his work for the Lord. At 16, at the chapel, he wanted a Sunday school class. He was given two children and told to increase the class or lose it. For the next 3 months, an elder sat in his class to evaluate his teaching and to give feedback. His commitment to soul winning and glorifying the Lord resulted that at the age of 27, the elders commended him to full-time service. Uncle Dave always saw the importance of family. He might not agree with us, but we knew he loved us. He would talk and pray with us, telling it like it was. No subject was too taboo. Maybe a little uncomfortable or difficult, but never taboo. He always had two questions for us. How are you doing with your walk with the Lord? And did you get enough to eat? We never left Uncle Dave's house without something to take home. The family Christmas dinner was particularly memorable. It was always held the Saturday before Christmas. Shrimp was mandatory, passing gifts on the word during the reading of the Christmas story, a piece of family history, and never leaving without a gift. Uncle Dave and Aunt Ruth were wonderful hosts to other Christmas gatherings, usually dinner with the cousins one night and the neighbors another night for St. Caroling and singing. Uncle Dave taught that you need to help meet physical needs to open the door to help meet spiritual needs. He was available to help the best way he knew how. One time, his sister-in-law, Ruth, Bill's wife, called him in February during a snowstorm to take her to the hospital because she was in labor with her third child. Dave, being still single and younger, when he got to the house, he was beside himself because she was in the shower getting ready to go. He kept saying, "We need to go. You're in labor." Uncle Dave enjoyed traveling and meeting new people. There's many of us that cherished his station wagon. Before seatbelts, we all used to fight over who got to sit in the very back. I remember that. Early station wagons were flat, just flat. I don't remember that, but Paula indicates that was happening. And he had the seats laid down flat, and the kids would get inside. Not culturally acceptable today, politically correct at all. And we would have tea parties and play during the drives. Later, the station wagons had seats you could pull up out of the flat part in the back. Didn't matter which model. Everybody wanted the very back of the station wagon. Uncle Dave was teased that someone in the family had outdone his station wagon. One great-nephew was the Oscar Mayer Wiener mobile driver. So he got upstaged finally. I remember one time we were going over to Canada. This isn't in the speech, but we were going over to Canada one time, and the guy at customs says, "Are all those your kids?" And in a sense, Uncle Dave probably said yes. You know, that was a great day. There were many trips to Niagara Falls with Uncle Dave. He always used these trips as an opportunity to witness for the Lord in handing out Niagara Falls cards. Many of you have seen those. With a scripture verse on the back that he had gotten printed. Great sunrise pictures of the falls, of the Horseshoe Falls, you know, and the gospel tract with it. After a full day of sharing the word, it was time for Chinese dinner. And from Aunt Ruth's time in the Orient, she was able to teach us to eat with chopsticks. There were many years Uncle Dave took many of us to New York City the afternoon of Thanksgiving. These trips were a mixture of sightseeing and visiting the Spanish Assembly. Anyone who went on one of those trips has a story. Everyone stayed at the campgrounds, a church, or a home, depending on the size of the group. What an experience between the seven-hour drive each way and the sights, seeing Amish country, going to the Landis farm, Chinese dinner in a restaurant that only spoke Chinese. I remember one of the latter trips I didn't go on, but the people that went on it told us that, and at night there was gunshots outside and there were game fights outside. And it was a total new education for some of our sheltered Blaisdell people. You know? There's a whole other world out there. As a couple, Uncle Dave and Aunt Ruth brought diverse people and cultures as well to us. Their home was always open to provide hospitality to missionaries, speaking at the assembly, or just passing through. They would host international students every Christmas and Memorial Day. They also provided a place to stay for suitors looking for their soulmate. Can you believe that? Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Uncle Dave was quite a matchmaker, but he would disagree and say, I just make introductions. Uh-huh. Never, who wrote this? Yeah, anyway, never give up. There's always hope. There's always hope, you know. Just look at him. He was in his early 40s when he found Aunt Ruth. I remember that. We were dumbfounded. But didn't think David would ever get married, you know. Sorry, I'm getting stuck there. Uncle Dave was devoted to his love of the Lord and doing his part to glorify his Savior. He believed very strongly that his proper field of service was in the local assembly, according to New Testament principles. At the assembly, he led by example through so many activities in Sunday school teaching, youth groups, missionary conferences, New Year's Eve services, the Jubilee or the centennial celebrations and parades. Then there was youth time, inner city rallies. That may have been where Dave and Uncle Bill were to speak and do some magic. Minutes before they were to go on stage, Uncle Dave told Uncle Bill, hurry up and give me your car keys. Bill says, we're supposed to go on any minute now. Dave persisted and then said, well, I split my pants from stem to stern. And Uncle Bill had to stall until Dave could get changed and trim on stage. Excuse me. We go to the city mission to sing for services and on other occasions work with Otis and Jerry Tillman in Buffalo with Sunshine Camp. I lost my place here. Yeah, there we go. If you worked with Uncle Dave, he'd remind you that the food needs to look good as well as taste good. Remember, thank you. Remember, looks, smells, tastes, okay? Thanksgiving pancake breakfast, he always reminded us that the pancakes need to be hot and fluffy, and the sausage needs to be crisp. Holding bake nights while doing holiday packages for those in the military. The corn roast, which in years back was held at his brother RJ's cottage out in Boston. Then there were senior dinners, Sunday school picnics where he gave object lessons for the message or worked on food committees. The Christmas soup tent we had in Blaisdell. He often did premarital counseling for numerous weddings, either officiating or catering. The Blaisdell Youth Conference, which he and Bob Spicer established back, in 58, just about 3 years after camp or 5 years after camp, 58 or 59. And the 20 of us were sitting there, and Dave says, or Bob Spicer says, you know, the young people's group down in Georgia puts their own conference on. You people could do that. And the 20 of us said, no, we can never pull that off, you know. And Dave said, yes, you could. Uncle Dave said, yes, you could. And he worked with us over the years. Bob went back, was still in the military. He had been stationed down in Georgia. And I think we had our 63rd last year. So we're just about several years underneath Camp Lilloli. But it's amazing how the Lord blessed the Young People's Conference. That was well started with Bob Spicer and Dave. Then there was caroling at Mercy Hospital, where Uncle Dave and some men would go into the rooms at Christmas time and give out the Word of God with a pencil. He had like five pencils, and the white one was Romans 3:23, all have sinned. And after about 3 or 4 years, the nurses would look for the pencils, and they'd always pick out somebody that they knew should have that pencil among their staff. Give him the white one. I always look forward to that. Uncle Dave mentored many of us young men. When I was young, his advice to the budding young preacher, if you're going to preach from the Word of God, know your subject and read the passage before you speak. 2 Timothy 2:2, commit these to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. Uncle Dave showed us in his everyday life to talk of God in our everyday life and put some feet to it, whether going to a restaurant or going to Aldi's on a chocolate run. He would be passing out bookmarks, for Deuteronomy 6:5 through 9 tells us to have God in every aspect of our life. Many of the younger generation decided Uncle Dave needed to get with the times and started to referring to him as UD. He had earned their respect by listening, praying, searching scripture for an answer or guidance, and discussing hard topics to teach according to scriptures, like head coverings, dress codes, premarital sex. It wasn't his job to make us comfortable. When we came to the meetings, it was his job to open our eyes to the fact that we were sinners going to hell if we hadn't accepted Christ. We needed to get lost before we could get saved. Just like many of his blacklight messages shared, such as Moses and the Israelites eating the Passover, Uncle Dave would flip on the blacklight and the angel of death was there passing over those covered by the blood. We are here remembering someone we've loved and respected, yet Uncle Dave would tell us Don't look. In fact, you heard this from Jason in his prayer. Don't look at me or any other person. Look up. The two O's there are for the eyes in that word, look, to help remind you to keep your eyes on the Lord, the only one who can save us and the only example to follow. As we reminisce of wonderful times over the years with Uncle Dave, our real desire, as his real desire would be, is to focus on the Lord Jesus Christ, who he is, and what he can do in any life which is submitted to him. Uncle Dave tried to give the Lord preeminence in all that he did and said, and as a consequence, the Lord used him in mighty ways for his glory in spreading the gospel. Only when we get to heaven will we see the extent of the Lord's working through him. Now, it's interesting, being on the Camp Corporation board of Camp Lilloli, we get Dave and Ruth shared letters from people that had gone to camp 40 years, 50 years ago, you know, and it's interesting how many lied. One young man became only gone to camp 1 year, got saved, became a pastor, and he's been pastoring for 30 years or so in his church and has seen hundreds come to know the Lord. And part of that was because he heard the word of God at Camp Lilloli. And it's amazing. And Dave and Ruth have many, many letters similar to that. Uncle Dave served his master faithfully in this world and is now face to face with him in the next, sitting at the feet of the Lord and resting in the goodness of his love. We miss him here, and we look forward with yearning and desire to cross that great divide and join him in the hallelujah choruses to the one who died for us and live, and that we might live eternally with him in heaven. Mike?
It's wonderful, isn't it, to be able to laugh together at a funeral. It's all because of the Lord Jesus Christ and knowing that our loved one is in his presence. Now I'd like to invite Mr. Mark Drum, a longtime friend from camp, to minister to us in music, please. Mark. Thank you, Mark. I'm going to invite Mr. Brian Gunning up to have some reflections on the family meetings. Brian?
Well, thank you very much, and it certainly is a real privilege and honor for me to participate here in this wonderful service this morning to commemorate the great man we knew as Uncle Dave. I've been asked to speak a few words on memories of family meetings, and I'd like to begin by reading a verse from the New Testament, well known to many of us, I'm sure, the words of Peter, the apostle of our Lord Jesus Christ, when he wrote these words in 1 Peter 1:23, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. My first recollection of Uncle Dave goes back over 50 years when he came to the Pelham Road Gospel Chapel in St. Catharines for daily vacation Bible school. And I remember that was the first time I'd ever seen the felt stories, the flannel graph stories presented in a way that Uncle Dave presented them. We were all mesmerized by the black light, and to this day, I still don't know how it works, and I'm not interested in a boring scientific explanation. I'd rather enjoy the mystery and magic of it all. But even as a boy of about 10 or 11 years of age, that remained in my mind as Uncle Dave brought those Bible stories to us. Later on, as he got more involved in the work of Camp Lailolai, he arranged or designed what he called family meetings, and used to come to the Brockview Bible Chapel for many, many years for a week of family meetings. How many have attended family meetings? You raised your hands. Well, then you'll know a lot about what I'm going to say. Uncle Dave or Aunt Ruth would call on a Saturday evening and say, we'll be coming over to the chapel to get set up, and we would meet them over there, and we'd unload the boxes of the prizes and the felts and the lights and the memory cards and the points and all the things that went along with family meetings. We'd get all set up on a Saturday night, ready to start on a Sunday morning for the week of family meetings. And they were a tremendous event, as many of you that attended family meetings know. It attracted all kinds of people, people that we hadn't seen at the chapel for years. They would be attracted to family meetings, and they would come. And every night, Sunday, and every night through the week to Friday, we would meet for family meetings. And no subject was untouchable in family meetings. We covered lots of ground. I remember one year he came, and he announced that the series was going to be on the seven churches of Revelation. I cringed. The seven churches of Revelation on the felts and the black light and the audience of young and old. How on earth are you ever going to teach that? Of course, he taught it. All seven churches, the whole week long. Our children were young at the time, and after the meetings were over and Uncle Dave left, and a few weeks later, one Saturday afternoon, I was at the house, and I could hear our children playing downstairs. And as you know, children like to imitate. And one of them took on the role of Uncle Dave and set up a board, and they were teaching the seven churches of Revelation. There was the gum tree. Now, I'm not a gum chewer, but with Uncle Dave had a rule, there was no gum chewing at the meeting. That was a no-no. And so he came up with the idea of the gum tree, which would be a stick of a branch of a tree, and it would be put in some kind of a container. And if you were chewing gum when you came into the chapel, you were to go and deposit your gum on the gum tree, unless, of course, you were a nervous adult. I never knew whether you were supposed to go back and retrieve your gum off the gum tree, but that was the rule. There were the prizes and the points. For coming, you'd get 3 points, I think it was, for bringing a Bible. You'd get another 2 points, that'd be 5 points. If you brought a friend, you'd get 10 points. I think some nights they had a premium on, you'd get 20 points if you brought a friend. For answering questions, for saying the memory verse, for winning in the sword drill, you got points, and you all remember the point cards with a verse of scripture on the point card. But don't lose your cards. If you lost your cards, that was your problem. You weren't going to get them back. And then, of course, there was the famous three. And Uncle Dave, if Uncle Dave used the number three any time before the lesson was started, before the lights went out and the lesson started, the first one on their feet were to say the memory verse. And that was always a great challenge for the competitive ones to be the first on their feet to say the memory verse. The young tried it, the old tried it, those who were good with English tried it, those who weren't so good with English tried it, everybody tried it. I remember one year there was a woman there who was so enthusiastic about it. She was about 8.5 months pregnant, and she was determined she was going to say her verse, and she jumped to her feet when Uncle Dave said three. And the next morning, she went into labor. And she says it was Uncle Dave that got that going. That little baby is 35 years old now and has three children of her own. Be careful when you hear the number three. We were challenged to do the memory work, to answer the question, to participate in the sword drill. And often you'd venture to answer a question, but you were wrong. Or you tried to say the memory verse, but it all fell apart when you stood on your feet. But even if you couldn't get it right, you were still loved. The children were okay. It was the adults who were always the problem. And of course, we couldn't forget Aunt Ruth's role in all of this. She came and played the piano to accompany the singing of the choruses that Uncle Dave would bring to us, choruses we didn't often sing, and he'd always have it on the card, you know, he'd hold it up, and he would get us to sing until we got it right, and Uncle and Aunt Ruth played the piano, and then when the singing was over, she would just quietly slip out and go downstairs and get everything ready for the prizes when the meetings were over and people would go down and spend their points. She was always there at the Bibles and could get you a good Bible, could tell you all about the different kinds of Bibles. It was a tremendous service. We always enjoyed family meetings, and we always had a lot of fun at family meetings, and we always learned a lot at family meetings. But family meetings were not a carnival. They weren't a circus. Uncle Dave had a strategy in every component of the family meetings. It took me quite a few years to figure that out. But after observing them, I began to realize he had a reason for what he did. You see, the points were a very simple way of giving out prizes. You didn't have to keep records. You didn't have to punch cards. And it kept us from being distracted and all that kind of administrative work that would have complicated the meetings and distracted people from talking with people. The memory verse, as people jumped up through the week to say their memory verse on the word three, by the time the week was over, we'd heard that verse said 20 or 30 or more times. And then that verse usually had something to do with the messages that he gave during the week, and it all began to tie together. As Uncle Dave brought us questions each night about the previous night's lesson, He wasn't asking those questions to test us. He was asking those questions to test himself, because he wanted to see that if we couldn't answer the questions, then he felt that he had failed to explain the lesson clearly enough, and so he would adjust his presentation based on whether or not we were getting it. For the entire program, the entire set of meetings, and all that was involved in them, were designed that he might infect us with the Word of God. He wanted us to learn God's word because he knew this timeless truth of Peter, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the word of God that liveth and abideth forever. That Uncle Dave was steeped in the word of God. Everything he gave out had the word of God on it. That was his objective. What a tremendous example he has set for us. You know, most of us, when we get up to speak in an auditorium like this, the lights are on. We have an open Bible in front of us to refer to. But if you remember in the family meetings, the lights weren't on. There was no open Bible. He told me one year how many verses he had to memorize for a single week of meetings. I've forgotten the number, but it was a staggering number of verses that every night he would just repeat them by memory. And if he couldn't get it quite right, on rare occasions, I noticed, he wouldn't just let it pass, like most of us do. He would stop, he'd go over, he'd take the dark glasses off, he'd open his Bible, he'd look it up, and he would read it to us. He didn't want to misquote it on the rare occasion he had to do it. Most of it was pure memory as he brought to us the Word of God. We are in debt to Uncle Dave as he made the Word of God live with timeless truth and real life applications. These are my recollections of the family meetings. Being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever.
Thank you, Brian. I will have a video presentation that was produced by Mr. Brian Cretney, please.
When we started, I can't tell you, but I got over seven.
In 67. Back in the 60s.
In the 60s, you think it was? Probably early 60s. Yeah, because I was doing it before. Yeah. And anyways, I got over 7,000 on the list. The last count was 7,400, but I haven't counted it for the last 2 years.
Their pain
passing now.
We saw a lot of pictures at camp. We're happy to have Mr. Terry Wilson, the camp administrator here, Camp Lailolai, and he's going to have some thoughts from camp. Terry?
Well, thank you very much. It is a real privilege to be asked to say a few words about the relationship between Camp Lailolai and our brother, Uncle Dave, and a term of great affection, Uncle Dave. You know, I came to camp after he was somewhat retired from camp work. He wasn't active there the way he was many years prior to that. But I can tell you that I hear his voice and feel his presence every week of camp. And certainly I hear imitations of his voice every week. And there's some who have got it remarkably well done. And it's a term of great affection for him and for the influence that he had at camp. You know, I was asked to say just a few words about Uncle Dave and his connection to camp, but we could literally sit here for hours and talk about the stories of Uncle Dave. I'm sure that everybody here probably has a dozen stories of incidents in their life, of impacts in their life that he had over the years. And so I'm pretty sure as I look out here, I can see very many of you that I know from camp And I would say that probably a large percentage of those that are here and watching on the video feed today somehow were involved with camp at some point. And it was very special to him. He was involved in many other things, including the family meetings and other things. But for us at Camp Lailolai, he will be forever a part of the fabric of camp. His presence will be felt. Many of our directors will point back to the trailer talks and some of the other things that happened in their lives. And you'll see variations of some of the things that he taught them and shared with them over the years. You know, he was a very unique and unforgettable character, but he accomplished remarkable things for the Lord and for eternity during his life. But you know, if you had asked him about that, about many of the remarkable things that he had accomplished, he would have told you that he did not believe that he was a man who had special gift or special talents or abilities. He was just an ordinary man who was used by the Lord to do extraordinary things because he was willing to surrender his life and his heart and his will to the Lord and be used by the Lord. You know, he wanted to always to bring glory to the Lord in all the things that he did. And we've been reminded of that several times today. You know, oftentimes we look at others and we see that much of what they do is to puff themselves up and inflate their own reputations. Not the case with our brother, Uncle Dave, a humble man, a man of great talents. You know, many of the things that he did and we marvel at and we are amazed at are things that you and I could do, but often don't. And I was reminded of this a couple of years ago when we'd been to Blaisdell Chapel one Sunday morning. And after the meeting, we went to lunch with Aunt Ruth and Uncle Dave and I think Larry and Cheryl Palmer and Jim and Bethel Lehman. And we went to a restaurant and we all got seated and sat down and began to say, "Where's Uncle Dave? Where is he?" Well, we looked around, and of course, before he came to sit down, he had gone to every diner in that restaurant that day. He had given them a card with a bookmark with a verse on it, and he'd had a short word with each of them, including the hostess, the servers, and the busboys. They all received something that day that pointed them to the Lord. And, you know, we could do that. All of us could do something like that, but how often do we? He lived his life that way. You know, late last year, we went to visit our brother when he was not well. He was up in the hospital. And as we came to his room, his voice was very faint. He looked very frail and very small, lying in his bed. And as I took hold of his arm to speak with him, I was actually quite shocked at how thin he had become. You know, he was always a healthy man and a healthy appearance. And yet he was somewhat shrunken there in that bed as he lay there. And yet his mind was sharp and his focus was still on the Lord and serving the Lord. Every nurse that came into that room, every doctor, every aide, every cleaner, every visitor heard about the Lord Jesus Christ, which something was shared. And he shared with us how many conversations that he'd had with the various people that came there to visit him. We have those same opportunities every day. How often do we use them? One of the things that I remember so well about our brother, and many of these things I'm hearing secondhand because I wasn't there when he was actively involved in camp, but was his great ability to pour himself into the lives of other people. He invested himself in the development of other people. Several years ago, by way of example, there was a couple that from the Midwest, and I'm not sure if they're here today, I don't see them, but they were visiting in the area and they came out to camp. They just drove into camp to take a look around. That happens quite often at camp where people just show up at camp and want to take a look around. Sometimes it's by accident. They think they can get through camp and discover that we're a dead end at one end and they have to turn around and drive all the way back out again. But most are coming there to remember the things that happened in their lives. Well, the wife of this couple had come to camp many, many years before, first as a camper and then later as a counselor. And she had grown up and moved away from the area and was now married. And her husband had never been to camp before. And so she wanted to bring him to camp and show him the place where many of the greatest spiritual milestones in her life took place. And she shared with us a story of when she was a young counselor, perhaps a junior counselor, about 16 years old. And the one night she was on her way back with her girls, heading back towards the girls' area after chapel. And it was a night when our brother, Uncle Dave, had given a very powerful gospel message. And as they walked together back to the cabins, one of her young campers said to her, "I want to get saved tonight." And so she thought quickly. This was the first time somebody had ever asked her that question. And so she said to the camper, "Well, why don't we wait until tomorrow and we can talk with Uncle Dave?" And the little girl said to her, "No, I want to get saved right here, right now, sitting on this rock outside cabin 11. And she got into a little bit of a panic, wasn't quite sure what she should do next. And so she said, "Wait right here. I'm going to go and get Uncle Dave." And so she ran up to the chapel to get Uncle Dave. And she told him the story. "I have somebody there that needs to hear about the gospel." And you know, Uncle Dave said to her, "You can do this. You know the truth. You know the gospel. You can do this." But he gave her a little booklet with some helpful verses in it. And he said, "Go back and talk to her." And so you went back to the young girl, and she said to her one more time, "Okay, wait right here. I have to go and read a booklet first." And she went into her cabin while the camper sat there, and she read this booklet. And the very first section of this booklet had to do with how to have assurance of salvation, how to have assurance of faith. And you know, as she read this, this young counselor realized that this was the message that she needed in her life. She was saved. She knew she was saved. But sometimes she had doubts. And as she finished reading those verses that given to her by our brother, she suddenly, for the first time, felt, "I have full assurance of my faith." And a peace just washed over her. And she went outside and she pointed that young girl to the Lord. And you know, that night there were two lives that were changed. One came to know the Lord Jesus Christ for the first time. And one received the assurance that she needed, that she was saved. And from that point on, her life was never the same. Either of these girls. That lady went on to serve the Lord and still, some 40 years later, is still serving the Lord faithfully, leading people to the Lord. She lives out in the Midwest. Her husband is an elder in one of the assemblies out there. But she can point back to that situation, that circumstance, that night, her interaction with our brother, that was life-changing for her and for this young girl. One of the other ministries, of course, that our brother was so well known for, and we've alluded it to a couple of times today, was the birthday card ministry. What a faithful ministry that is. How many people have passed through camp and who are still today, I'm sure if we asked for a show of hands, many of you would still be receiving your birthday cards today. What a great work that is. You know, I receive constant phone calls and emails and Facebook messages from people who are amazed that even after all of these years, they still get that birthday card every year from Uncle Dave. You know, a couple of years ago, I had a call from a dad who told me a little bit about his son. His son was today in his late 20s, came to camp when he was a young man. And his life has gone through many ups and downs. His dad is not sure if he's actually saved, but over the years, this young man has continued to seek after the Lord. He's gone from church to church and never really settled, never found a church where he could call home, never found a person that he could call a real friend. Often he would go to a church for a number of months and then leave, just leave in discouragement. And he said nobody ever called him. Nobody ever followed up to say, "Why have you not, you know, why aren't you still coming to church? What happened?" He said the dad said the only spiritual constant in this young man's life over 20 years, nearly 20 years, was that birthday card that came every single year. that came to him with a bookmark and a tract and something else that would be of an encouragement to him. And so his dad said he was so grateful that somebody spiritually cared for his son even after all of these years. As we think of our brother, I think of the fact that we have done just this a number of times in the last couple of years. Over the past few years, we've attended many funerals of those who were connected with camp. Our brother, Uncle Bill Ferguson. I was going to say partner in crime to our brother, but maybe partner in adventure with our brother. The two of them just really made the Bible come alive for our young people. And the focus, as we were reminded today, has always been on the Lord Jesus Christ. We lost our brother, Mel Northrup, the man who really had originally the burden for having a camp. He is gone. Jim Bottomley was another one of the early directors of camp. He is gone. And you know, as we think about these ones who have gone before and who are now gone on to glory and to the reward and to meet with their Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, it reminds me that we are still here. And the baton, the burden has been passed to us, the responsibility is passed to us to continue to go on for him as they did and to live our lives faithfully and wholeheartedly for the Lord. You know, none of us will ever be Uncle Dave. He was a one of a kind. He was a unique man, a truly unique man. But the Lord is calling every single one of us to serve as he served, as our brother served. You know, we would love it if you would come and serve at camp alongside of us. But you know, the Lord did not wait for our brother to come to camp to serve. He served wherever he was. And perhaps the Lord is calling you to share his name in a restaurant or in a supermarket or in a schoolhouse in your school or your home or your workplace or your neighborhood. Wherever you are, the Lord is calling us. And you know, we honor our brother and the memory of our brother and others like him when we do as they do, not thinking of ourselves, but thinking of the Lord and the work that he did. I was reading in the book of Colossians recently, and I came across this commendation that Paul had for his co-worker, Tychicus. And I think it's the same commendation that we would leave with our brother today. Paul said of him in chapter 4 of Colossians, "He is a beloved brother, a faithful minister, and a fellow servant in the Lord." We rejoice that he is in the Lord's presence today. We'll miss him. We certainly have already begun that, missing our brother. But I'm so grateful for the stories and the memories and the reminders that we have of his life. And I would encourage you to do as he did. Put the Lord first in your life and make service for him our first priority. Thank you.
Thank you, Terry. Take your song sheets, please. We're going to sing Emmanuel's Land. This is one of my very favorites, and you can't sing Emmanuel's Land sitting down, so we're going to all stand up. We're going to sing this song, Emmanuel's Land.
Oh,
be seated. I'd like to invite a longtime family friend, Mr. J.B. Nicholson, up to share some thoughts from God's Word this morning.
Well, as we've already heard several times, it's no surprise that it was Uncle Dave's desire that this time of remembrance would focus on the Lord Jesus and not on Uncle Dave. And so I'd like to begin by reading a passage from Isaiah 42, quoted in Matthew 12, verses 18 to 21. "Behold, my servant whom I have chosen, my beloved in whom my soul is well pleased. I will put my spirit upon him, and he will declare justice to the Gentiles. He will not quarrel nor cry out, nor will anyone hear his voice in the streets. A bruised reed he will not break, and smoking flax he will not quench, till he sends forth justice to victory, and in his name Gentiles will trust." I'd like to think a little bit about what it means to be a servant, especially a servant of the Lord. You notice the prophecy concerning the Lord Jesus, this one that Uncle Dave loves so dearly, explains to us that the greatest person who ever walked the planet chose to be a servant. We read that he lived only to please his Father. And he had a message to preach to the nations. He wasn't interested in promoting himself. And he would be gentle with bruised and broken people. Wherever he saw even a little faith, he would fan it into flame. He would be trustworthy because he would be truthful. And the amazing thing is that ordinary people like Uncle Dave could be like their master in this. And he believed that everyone could learn the joy of servanthood. We've already heard, and everybody who knew Uncle Dave knew, that he was an exotic flower in the garden of the Lord. When I came in here today, I looked around. There was something missing. No big hug. That voice that somehow rose to a level, sort of, he had his own frequency. And it didn't matter how many people were in the room talking, you always got Uncle Dave's message. And it was always the same, right? I mean, he would tell us today, this isn't complicated. Love God with all your heart. Believe his word, every bit of it. Care for others. Keep your eye on heaven. Be instant in prayer. That was his life. And he thought everybody could live like that. And they can, by the grace of God. One of the great ideas that is so confused in Christendom today, that was a clear message from Uncle Dave. You cannot serve him until he saves you. The church is full of messages that the way to heaven is by doing good. But he would be quick to quote to us Ephesians 2, 8 and 9. Many of us learned it first from him. That salvation is not by works. By grace you are saved through faith. And that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. So I want to think about some simple characteristics that are given to us in the Word of God of what it means to be a servant. And I think as we listen to these, someone will come to mind as the epitome of these characteristics. The first one, I'm going to read to you from Mark's Gospel, chapter 10, verses 43. Whoever desires to become great among you shall be your servant. And whoever of you desires to be first shall be slave of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many. Over Dave's life, Uncle Dave, we could write these words, content to let the world go by, to know no gain nor loss. He could have been a successful businessman. He could have been successful at anything he did. He threw himself into it with a passion. But he was born and died in the same house, on the same street, in the same town. Content to let the world go by. But you know, he had a skill in seeing opportunities and taking advantage of them. Aunt Ruth's family, some of the families from Australia, and she was invited to come, and I think her ticket was paid, but if Uncle Dave was going to join, he's going to have to pay his own way. Well, he heard there was a company that used to make board games or some sort of games, and they had auctioned, sold off everything else, and they were just going to plow some stuff under. And he couldn't see that happening. And so away he went and found out that there were boxes and boxes of these little figurines, little football players that used to go on a game. And so he took them. And he thought about this a bit and went down to a cake decorating supply company and took in a box and said, would you be interested in having some of these? And the fellow said, well, yeah, we could use some of those, but, you know, we have a big distribution here. We need a lot of them. And he said, I have a lot of them. And so he arrived at their store with a pickup truck load of these little figurines. And the fellow came out and said, wow, you do have a lot. He said, this is just half. I got another truckload. And with that, he paid his way to Australia. So the first characteristic of a true servant is to be unassuming, to be humble. And that characterized the man. Rather than desiring to be great himself, he was willing to take the low place and to serve others. How many times did we see him with an apron on? How many times when you came over, there he was working in the kitchen. He was always ready to step in and do what needed to be done. We need people like that today. And then secondly, a servant of God needs to be nurturing. You got to care about people and nurture them. 2 Timothy 2:24 to 26 says, a servant of the Lord must not quarrel, but be gentle to all, able to teach, patient, in humility correcting those who are in opposition, if God perhaps will grant them repentance, so that they may know the truth and that they may come to their senses and escape the snare of the devil. How many of us thank God that Uncle Dave had the love and courage to speak to us when our feet had well nigh slipped? He wasn't afraid to ask a few diagnostic questions and to provide some medicine for us to make us well again. I remember one day we were having an honest chat, and I said to him, Uncle Dave, you are the epitome of uncool. I mean his ties. And I'll never forget, he used to wear these white socks. And when the black light came on, I remember as a kid, when the black light came on, everything was black except these iridescent purple socks that moved back and forth across the platform as he spoke. But I said, you know, teenagers, they gather around you like bees to honey. What's the deal? And he looked me in the eye and he said, Jabe, it's very simple. Love them and tell them the truth. He was quoting the Lord, right? The principle of Scripture is speak the truth in love. Love them. And that's what we got. We got love and we got truth. When you bumped into Uncle Dave, we knew what we were going to get. Some of us avoided him at times because we knew he was gunning for us. And then listen to this. A servant must be consistent. You want somebody you can count on. Maybe he will, maybe he won't. You could count on Uncle Dave. When you met him, when you heard him preach, you knew what you were going to get.
When you met him on the street, you knew what you were going to get, right? He was consistent. Somebody mentioned this in my family, that when you looked at the Facebook notices, there was a consistency there. People kept saying the same thing. He wasn't into fads and tricks. He saw what worked and he kept at it. Sow the seed. The more you sow, the more you reap. So he stuck with prayer and preaching and seed sowing and witnessing and good works because he knew that's what God would bless him. He was consistent. Listen to these words in Matthew 25:23. His Lord said to him, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of your Lord." And then a good servant needs to be loyal. There was nothing fickle about him. He treated everybody the same. There are some people who go around and they hand out hugs selectively, but everybody was fair game on the day. And he was loyal. Luke 16:13 says, "No servant can serve two masters. For either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money." Now, Uncle Dave knew money. It was his joy to spend and be spent. He was one of the most generous people I know. Lots of people got their bills paid, hospital bills, groceries. Nobody even knew about it. You never went to his house and came away without something in hand. That was the way he was. And you know, he was great fun, but nobody made fun of the Lord or the Lord's faithfulness. That was not good. I remember being at the south end of the Temple Mount in Jerusalem, and our guide was trying to explain away the need for the shedding of blood. And she didn't realize that in the audience, this New Yorker that, you know, kind of wore funny clothes, and she had no idea that he brought out his big Bible bazooka. And I don't think she ever tried that one again. Without the shedding of blood is no remission, he said. He made it perfectly clear. He was loyal to the Lord. And then a good servant needs to be energetic, needs to be about the business. The Apostle Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians 9:19, "For though I am free from all men, I have made myself a servant to all, that I might win the more." That was right on the frontal lobe of Uncle Dave's brain. How could he win the more? He was always thinking about it. It's Memorial Day. Let's go into the graveyards and talk to people whose hearts are sensitive because they're thinking about their loved one and their own. Go down to Niagara Falls, but people are looking at the fall. Look, we get some Niagara Falls stuff, right? And we'll hand it out to them, and we'll tell them the story of Roger Woodward. He was the best guy if you ever wanted to see Niagara Falls right away. He could do it. And so when we think about the the energy that he gave to the things of God. He was no wimp. He was no sloppy. He didn't give up when things got tough. I was supposed to be speaking in Bladeville one night many years ago. It was a winter's night, and the snow was especially high. In fact, they'd shut down the streets of Buffalo. If you drove in Buffalo, they'd throw you in jail. And I called him up, and I said, well, what about the midweek meeting? And he said, what about it? And I said, well, I can't even drive through Buffalo. He said, no, you have to come around the back. I said, well, you know, who's going to be there? He said, you know what? Some people will make an excuse, and some people will make an effort. And the young guys in their four-wheel drive went around and picked up the widows, and everybody was there. Shut things down when the snow didn't blow, though. We only need 2 months of the summer. I'll never forget being at one of the Rise Up conferences, and on that particular conference, we were meeting at one end of the hotel, and at the other end, they were having a New Year's ball, a $500 plate fancy ball, everybody in their tuxedos and dresses. And what do you know, Uncle Dave was down there. As the crowd came out of the ball, he was there with the John 3:16 seat sower text. So nothing subtle about this. And he's handing them up. And there's a young lady, and she's on her way to go up to sin. The young man that's not. And he hands her one. And she took it, and she covered her face. And she said, don't give it to me. I'm a sinner. And I'm thinking, that's who it's for. It's for sinners. Oh, what a wonderful thing. To be energetic in the work of, you know, there are people passionate about golf and football and you name it, hockey, all sorts of things, making money. Uncle Dave was passionate about honoring the Lord in his life. And seeing other people enjoy the Lord Jesus the way he did. His Christianity was not some dry, ho-hum, humdrum sort of thing. It was the most exciting thing you could ever imagine. He wanted everybody to get in on what he had. And then, a good servant needs to be devoted. Needs to stick to the job. Needs to know what he's about. And Matthew 10:25 says, the Lord Jesus said, it's enough for a disciple that he be like his teacher and for a servant to be like his master. It was enough for him just to be like the Lord. Uncle Dave wanted to be like his master and everything. And one of the things that was very important to him was trusting the Lord for his daily needs. And, you know, that George had these big station wagons. I was being a little disrespectful, I suppose, but I really thought it would be cool if Uncle Dave's casket was taken to the grave in an Ambrose wagon. Blaisdell's famous for, you know, having cars with leprosy, right? I mean, there's lots of snow, lots of salt, and the cars really are treated badly. And both their cars were in very bad shape. And they came out of the prayer meeting one night, and they were walking over to the car, and this poor car was sort of leaning against the curb, limping, you know. And he said, Uncle Dave, is that verse still in the Bible? My God shall supply all your need according to the riches and glory. Yeah. And Uncle Dave said, well, we've been saving up a little money, you know, to get another one, and we had maybe 1,000 or 2 set aside. And I'm going to buy another one like this. And here's the honesty of Uncle Dave. Here's the humility. He said, you're right. I need the Lord to increase my faith. Would you pray for me right now that the Lord would increase my faith? And that Sunday, without a word to anyone else but the Lord, a brother came up to him and said, I'm concerned about your vehicle, and gave him a check, I think, for $15,000. I think, if I have my story right, he called Tom Long, who ran a Ford dealership and over in the Philly area, and said, do you think you could get me a good used car for the 15 plus the 1,000 or so that he had saved up? And Tom said, I don't think I'd get you a good used car for that price, but I think I'd get the new one. And so he ordered him a new car. But he's still driving the old car. He was down, I think, in Cincinnati, Northern Hilton, actually, at the family meetings. And the last evening, one brother was helping him carry the loads of stuff out to the car. And looks at this old car and says, is this what you're using to drive across the country? The guy says, you know, our company, we've got an old new disc cruiser. We're looking to get rid of it, and I wonder, would you be interested? So Uncle Dave told him the story about increased faith with the $15,000 check and the new car. But he said, you know, my wife could use the car. How much do you want for it? Well, Dad, I'm just going to give it. And so by the end of the week, they had two cars. The third week, I think he was in New York. He still was driving the old one. Ruth had the old one deal now, and he's still waiting for the Ford. And brother came up, looked at his car, and said, Uncle Dave, you need another car. He says, I'm in the auto auction business. And Dave said, I'm sorry, there's just room for two wagons in the driveway. A servant needs to be adaptable. In Acts 16, verse 17, we read the story how a little girl followed Paul and cried out, saying, these men are the servants of the Most High God who proclaim to us the way of salvation. Now, in that same section of the Bible, Paul had just led a dignified, upper-class businesswoman to the Lord, and is soon to be a pardoned jailer and his family to the Lord. That's one of the coolest things about Uncle Dave. I remember I grew up in the age of the generation gap. Like, he never heard of me. Little kids, old people, and everybody in young couples, teenagers, he was there for them. He was adaptable. Whatever the need, there he was, because he believed that God loved everybody and wanted everybody. He believed that. A lot of people don't believe that. Remember one time, we were going out to a Chinese restaurant. He loved to visit to a Chinese restaurant. And we were going out to a Chinese restaurant. I was babysitting David Gooding and John Lennox after the conference. And so he said to me, what kind of tracks do you give out in a Chinese restaurant? Tracks. I mean, I can't give out tracks. Same tracks to everybody. Not on the way. He's a specialist. He said, no, you've got to give out some of these. So he gave me some. This is about China, or kind of China or something. Like, you know, people have come to a Chinese restaurant. I'd be interested in that, right? But I couldn't do it. Because by the time we got to the restaurant, he'd already been there. And he and his wife were sitting in the public tracks. Everybody in the place. But he was always thinking about winsome ways to win. He was adaptable. In Luke 12:37, we discover that a good servant needs to be vigilant, needs to have his eyes open, to see needs, to respond to needs. And so it was with Uncle Dave. Blessed are those servants whom the master, when he comes, will find watching. Assuredly, I say to you, he will gird himself and have them sit down to eat and will come and serve them. He was like a good shepherd, always watching over the sheep. Fellows and girls started to get too friendly. When young couples were hiding some difficulty in their marriage, local church having problems. Remember one time? He drove 9 hours round trip because he was promised a couple of minutes with the young man who had ended up in prison. 9 hours round trip. finally, a good servant is an everlasting servant. Uncle Dave rests from his labors on earth, but he's not out of his position. He would want to just have an armchair to fly with him. We want to keep busy. Now, this is what Revelation 22 says, describing that wonderful place, the river and the trees, the street, and all the rest. It says there should be no more curse, but the throne of God and of the Lamb shall be in it, and his servants shall serve him. They shall see his face, and his name shall be on their foreheads. And they shall reign forever. You know something, ladies and gentlemen? Someday this world that's upside down is going to be turned right side up. The people who thought they were climbing to the top are going to be at the bottom. And those who humble themselves under the mighty hand of God are going to be at the top. The only job opportunities in the coming kingdom will be for servants. The greatest person in the universe who sits on the highest throne is there because he took the lowest place for us to come. We will be servant kings. And right now we're training for reigning. And the training is learning to serve. Learning to care. Learning to share the glorious message of the gospel. I dare say to think as many as in this room today to make up for what Uncle Dave used to do for all the 50. He was at it all. To think that Uncle Dave is really there. He's really there. Absent from the body, present with the Lord. To depart and to be with Christ, which is not better. I tell you, you hear people who despise the gospel, but when it comes to a funeral, they start making up fairy tales. I saw this butterfly land on my mother's favorite rose tree. I think it's my mother come back to walk over. You can have your butterflies, fairy tales. I don't take what God said to me here. We have this absolute choice based on the unchanging word of God. So what makes a good servant of God? You, unassuming. M, virtue. C, assistance. L, loyal. E, energetic. D, devoted. A, adaptable. V, vigilant. G, ever. That just happened to me. You recognize him before I ever said it. And that was the kind of servant he was. The vital question as we close is this. Are you going to see Uncle Dave again? He's there. Are you going to be there? If you knew Uncle Dave and he knew you, I can tell you two things for sure. That he talked to you about the Lord, and he talked to the Lord about you. And, you know, sometimes you got to get pushing. So he's got one more time. He got to get pushing. You hear the invitation one more time. Look unto me and be saved. All the ends of the earth. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you shall be saved. If you will confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. He that has the Son has life and shall not come into judgment, but is passed from death into life. But God so loved him that he gave his only begotten Son that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Same old gospel that Uncle Dave preached for those many years is the gospel he wanted you to hear one more time. And those of you who have trusted the Lord, with joy you say, thank God it's true. Jesus is the best thing that ever happened to me. I have this assurance that it won't be long. It could be minutes. It won't be long until we are gathered with them. It is the Lord of you, and so shall we ever be.
Song sheets and we'll sing Going Home.
Shall gather, or on the other shore, And when those call upon yonder, I'll be there. I'm going to be there. And the question again, will you? You've had an opportunity here, again, as I said, an invitation. Trust you might not be doing it right for me. Just stay there. Heavenly Father, we just applaud and give you thanks for what we've heard and heard by song and by word and by his life. And again, we pray for Aunt Ruth and the family. And I appreciate you and every one of us that's here as well. To continue to be with us this day. Again, thank you for this time we have. And just think of also about the door. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. Any man will open up, I will come to him. Again, as he had, as we see, about the right door, choosing the right door. We pray that people might choose the right door this day for salvation, that they might choose the right door for their life, and that you help them to do both of those things. We thank you again, and ask this in the name of Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
We have a female director in the poll there, so I'm going to remove the cast of the family and followed by everyone else. The interment ceremony will be at Hillcrest Cemetery. And immediately following that, everyone is invited back to Blaisdell Gospel Chapel for a time of fellowship and reflection and refreshment. That's immediately following the interment ceremony. Thanks.
We can believe that God will just as surely bring with Jesus all who are asleep in him. Here we have a definite message from the Lord. It is that those who are still living when he comes will not in any way precede those who have previously fallen asleep. One word of command, one shout from the archangel, one blast from the trumpet of God, and the Lord himself will come down from heaven. Those who have died in Christ will be the first to rise, and then we who are still alive on the earth will be swept up with them into the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And after that, we shall be with him forever. God has given me this message on the matter, so by all means, use it to encourage one another. There are glories untold in that city of gold on the brink of that beautiful river. Its wonderful light will burst on my sight, but what will it be to see him? There are some who have died that his name should abide. There are some who have lived for his glory. What bliss it will be their faces to see, but what will it be to see him? When in wonder I stand with my hand in his hand, in that home with the ransom forever, the sorrow all past and triumphant at last. But what will it be to see him? When the love light will shine from his eyes into mine, and the face that was marred is uplifted, with rapture complete, his smile I shall meet. Oh, what must it be to see him? In John's Gospel, chapter 20, we have the story of Mary of Magdalene. And all the others have left the graveside, but she can't leave. She's not even put off by two angels who spoke to her. She wouldn't be satisfied unless it was the Lord. And we read in verse 14, and when she had thus said, she turned herself back and saw Jesus standing, and knew not that it was Jesus. Jesus saith unto her, Woman, why weepest thou? Whom seekest thou? She, supposing him to be the gardener, said to him, Sir, if thou hast borne him hence, tell me where thou hast laid him, and I will take him away. Jesus said unto her, Mary. She turned herself and said to him, Rabboni, which is to say, my master. She, supposing him to be the gardener. The first man, Adam, was put into a garden, but God told him, if you eat of the fruit, you will die. And of course they did. And Adam turned this garden of a world into a graveyard. And the ultimate statistic is this, that one out of every one dies. We're all headed this way, aren't we? But the second man, the last Adam, the Bible says that the place wherein he was crucified, the place where he tasted death for everyone, there was a garden. And in the garden, a new tomb, and they buried him in a garden. And Mary, when she saw him standing, she supposed he was the gardener. And she wasn't far wrong, was she? Because for the Christian, the Lord has turned this graveyard of a world back into a garden. We're not going to bury this body. The Bible says he'll be planted. Uncle Dave's not in this box. He's in the presence of the Lord. But this body is not to be thought of lightly. This body was created by the Lord for his purpose. And it was the repository of the Holy Spirit of God from the time he was seven until he went home to heaven. And it was purchased by the precious blood of Christ. It's part of the redemption price. And this body is going to be reconstituted like his own glorious body someday. And so we don't think lightly of this. We're not of these people who say, well, just throw it in the trash. It doesn't matter. This is precious to God. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. But dear Christian, you don't bury seeds. If you do, they never come up. You plant them. Now, this is just a little wrinkled seed. Imagine what he's going to be when he flowers in glory. We can hardly imagine it. And so, when people say, you know, we lost Uncle Dave, well, we know exactly where he is. He's not lost. No, we know exactly where he is. And we're going there too. And this is the hope, the real and certain hope of the people of God. And so we just want to pray now and commit this body to the care of the Lord until that moment when we'll see him again. Notice what the scripture says. We shall be caught up together with them. Part of heaven is the joy of reunion. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. So let's just pray, and then we're going to sing. I love to sing in the graveside in sweet defiance of the enemy. The last enemy's death. And we just say, you haven't won this one. Oh, death, where is your sting? Oh, grave, where is your victory? The sting of death is sin. The strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Our Father, we can hardly believe it, but we say with the apostle, as sorrowful, yet always rejoicing, we are so thankful for having known Uncle Dave, for having been able to sit under his ministry and learn from him, not just from his preaching, but from his life. Oh God, we hear the apostle say, follow me as I follow Christ. May it be true in all of our hearts. Lord, I want to be more devoted. I want to be more busy in your service. I want to be more loving of your people, more ready to help like Uncle Dave was. Help us, Father, to take this seriously and to live out the life that he encouraged us to live in Christ. We commit this body into your care. You're such a good Father. You've cared for Uncle Dave all these years. You took his tent down gently. You took him home easy. And now he's there in your presence, rejoicing. Oh, what singing! To hear his voice above the rest, praising the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Oh, God, we're thankful for the reality of it. We pray for these children gathered around the grave. We pray that this might be an experience in their own lives when they realize that death doesn't win. Christ has won and gives us the victory. And we'll meet each other again in the blessed hope we then commit for a little time. This body that was the vehicle by which you manifested your love to us and your truth to us through the life of Uncle Dave. We tenderly commit the family who loved him most and will miss him most, that they will know the everlasting arms underneath and the grace of God in their lives. And again, for any wayward souls among us, oh God, bring them home. Bring them home. For those who are still lost, what a desperate thing to go to hell having heard the gospel from the lips of Uncle Dave. We pray that they might today close in with the offer of mercy and be saved. And so we just commend ourselves into your care. And seek, O God, the God of all comfort, the Father of mercies, that you will help Aunt Ruth in these coming days. Help us to take seriously the scripture that it's true religion to visit the widows, and that she might continue to flourish in her own ministry as she seeks to care for others. We just commend ourselves now in the name of the one who defeated death for us and opened heaven to us, and has promised to return for us, our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen. When peace like a river.
The sweet light in
amongst those awaiting. And we shall behold him then face to face. And we shall behold him. We shall be be changed.